Okay, so this is a data insights event, which is one of the things that the National Innovation Center for Data does. And our partners today, Wyoming Interactive, so I'll just kind of talk a little bit about this. So the data insights events are co-hosted by National Innovation Center for Data and some of our partners and friends. The idea is that we can bring people here, we can create a bit of conversation around data and what we can do with data science, and really create this ecosystem of people that can be innovative with data. Yeah. So there's three kind of themes to what we do in terms of data insights. So it's about data strategy, it's about best practice, and it's about technology choices, okay? So this is what we've got today. Great news, we've already done the doors open, so tick that one off. We'll see how the welcome pans out at the end, you can rate me on that. So I'm gonna talk a little bit about National Innovation Center for Data, about who we are. I'm not gonna take up too much time, but hopefully I can set the scene a little about who we are, right? So this is a very short video that I'm gonna show you, which explains in a lot more succinct way than I ever could who we are and what we do.
The global economy is undergoing a data-driven revolution. Public and private sector organisations that can interpret data can use the insights to vastly improve the way they operate. The National Innovation Centre for Data, or NICD for short, has been established to enable all organisations to improve their data capabilities and expertise so that they can solve problems and seize new opportunities. Created with funding from the UK Government and Newcastle University, NICD is very different to a data consultancy. Our role is to strengthen the UK economy by transferring data skills to organisations of all sizes, from small and medium-sized enterprises to huge corporates and public sector bodies like the NHS, so that we can address the UK shortage of data skills. Our data science experts will work with your team, supporting your project. We'll take the journey with them, navigate and help steer them towards the best solution, whilst introducing them to new data skills and techniques. We'll help them deliver an immediate return on your project by working to improve your productivity, increase your efficiency, or develop new and innovative products and services. And your team will learn how to apply what they've learned to future projects. Of course, learning doesn't stop when the project ends. You become part of the NICD ecosystem, connected to like-minded people and organisations. You can stay in touch and benefit from the shared knowledge and access to our talent pipeline of data science graduates. So the next time a data challenge or opportunity arises, your people will have the skills and the support network to manage, analyse and interpret data so that your organisation can flourish.
Okay, good. So the kind of take-home message from that, the parts in bold here. So their own people on their own platforms with their own data. So we're kind of like the co-pilot or the co-driver in that scenario where we're holding the map and we're kind of saying, okay, down here, turn left, and we're helping people to get to where they want to be. There's a bunch of stuff we do within NICD. So NICD Insights, which is where we are today. We do NICD Connections, which is about trying to partner different organisations up, trying to make sure that we can create these sort of innovative relationships that are going to happen. And then lastly, we've got the skills projects. And the skills projects is what I've just talked about there, where we're the co-pilot or the co-driver, and we help you along the way to deliver insight on your own data. We're here in the Catalyst building, which is a really good kind of beacon for all this kind of innovation with data science. So National Innovation Centre for Data, we're here. National Innovation Centre for Ageing. There's a bunch of startups, big corporates, and we're all here in this kind of innovation hub, if you like, centrally in a place that's got more sensors than any other place in Europe, yeah? We've got this ecosystem as well. We've got a bunch of those kind of companies that I mentioned. We've got collaborators in this building. We've got SMEs. We've got big corporates, students, those kind of things. And then NICD has got this really, really strong technical team. We have extremely rare skills in some of these really high-level data science techniques and algorithms that we want to use. ultimately, what we're trying to do as a National Innovation Centre for Data is to deliver those things in the top right-hand corner, okay? So we're trying to get return on investment. We're trying to get skills into industry and into organisations. So that's kind of everything for me. That's the sales pitch from a National Innovation Centre for Data at the start. I'm going to introduce the guys from Wyoming on stage soon. So we've got Rob Innes, who's the director and head of consultancy. We've got Simon Bevis, who's Wyoming's head of design. And then we've got Macarena López-Hidalgo, got that right, who's digital marketing executive as well. So I'm going to hand over to these guys now, who are going to take you through this workshop. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Richard. Thanks a lot. I forgot about that. Thanks for the introduction. Well, actually, this is our first event as well, face-to-face after 2 years or more, thanks to COVID. So this is actually exciting to see new faces. Well, as Wyoming, I'm going to introduce a bit about us. So we are a digital consultancy. We are based in Edinburgh, but we operate globally. And our services include user experience design, software engineer, data science, and demand generation. So in other words, we help organizations to improve commercial outcomes through digital transformation. Well, the presentations, thanks Richard, already did, but actually today Mastak Salabati was supposed to be here, but unfortunately he has been tested positive for COVID, so he cannot be here today, but my colleague Rob will and my colleague Simon will show you the case study that he prepared for you, so I hope that you will enjoy it. Well, yes, why are we here? Well, we are here to share the value of design thinking to better manage complex data to make better decisions. So we are going to, hopefully at the end of the session, if we do things right, you will understand how to help more people in your organizations to access data that they can act on to make better decisions. We are going to spend like 2 hours together, so I think that is a good time to go through all the parts of the session so you know what to expect. So in the first part, my colleague Simons will go through what is design thinking, how we can apply design thinking for complex data, and we will show you some good and bad examples as well. And at the end, we will also mainly focus on how can you understand your audience better to make the right data, to show the right data to the right people at the right time. Of course, none of this will matter if there's no commercial benefits behind that. So my Rob colleague will also go through all the commercial benefits of using this approach of design thinking for complex data. After this part, we will show the case study that Mastak Salabati prepared. The idea is we work with Roslin Institutes at that time, and our main challenge was figuring out how can show biological complex data for different personas using a same digital tool. So we will go through that case study, and then you will have a session to ask all the questions that you have, so please don't be shy. And after that, at the end of the session, we have prepared an interactive demo, an experiment in the wisdom of crowds, where we will prepare an interactive demo to show but we are going to simulate a package delivery, and actually you are going to participate there. So you will decide what to do based on the data that you are going to be seeing. We are going to use Slido. I don't know if you have ever used Slido, sorry. But if you just grab your phone and you access Slido, you will then insert a code event and you will be able to see a poll with different questions and multiple answers, and you will just need to answer. So yeah, I encourage you all to participate and just pick the the answers based on the data that you will be seeing. First things first, let's start talking about design thinking for complex data, because we are all here familiar with complex data. We are here to collect in data, model data, but we all know that all the data in the world is useless if we don't know how to use it well. So our main approach with design thinking is all about make things easier for the user. Actually, there's, well, sorry, I just look for a second. This is actually the first time speaking with so many people in English. in Spanish will be so much easier. But yeah, user experience at the end of the day is all about getting users to go to point A to point B in the less frustrating way as possible. So that's what we do in our day to day. We actually have a lot of experience developing software to make just things easier for the user, so different personas access the same platform and they can actually do something useful with that data. This is one example of a software that we developed. It's a bit of complex software. I'm not going to explain everything, but we have done customer experience portals, data management portals, sales enablement tools, or product selector tools. It's something that we have a lot of experience doing for life science organizations especially. But now I will just pass on to Simon so he will explain more about design thinking for complex data, and I think that you will find everything really useful. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me all right? Great. So thanks for the intro, Macarena. That was great. It probably helps to start with a definition, but it's probably not that easy. If you Google around, you're not going to find a clear definition. Popularized probably in the last 15 years or so, especially in the last 5 years. Design thinking was coined originally some decades prior to that. But like I say, no clear definition, which sort of makes my job quite easy. But if you were to Google it, what you're going to find is a lot of diagrams like this. And I'm going to warn you in advance that I am fairly pragmatic in how I approach things and not particularly academic. When I look at diagrams like this in different domains, I think that if I don't apply them in exactly the right way or follow them through from end to end, then somehow it might not be a success. I'm not going to get any value from this at all. That's not true. So one of the things that I'd like you to take away from this segment is the idea that even if you take just a small piece of this and you think it's valuable, great. That's all you need to do. My particular favorite example is that one on the bottom right, because the idea that anyone could really understand what that is from the office. It's just nonsense, really. You're also going to see a lot of words if you start to look into design thinking. Same for user-centered design, user experience, things like that. Tons of words. Ideate, empathize, solutionize. There's one there, expansive thinking. Now, I don't use any of those words in a professional capacity, nor would I. I couldn't say to one of the other designers at Wyoming, let's go and do some design thinking, or let's go and solutionize, because I'm just not going to do that. And so what I've tried to do is convert it into plain English where I can, but I'm not immune from using buzzwords, from using some of that jargon, so hopefully I won't do it too much. One thing you're also going to see if you Google for design thinking and try and find an answer online, especially if you're looking at blogs, images like this. Unrealistically happy people, unrealistic work settings, and almost always using post-it notes. And post-it notes are not design thinking. They are just little bits of paper. And actually, if you look at this image, you'll see there's not actually any writing on any of the post-it notes, which I actually think is quite a good metaphor for some of the, I don't know how to describe it, some of the myth around design thinking, the nonsense, really, that you can get sucked into, as well as also creating quite a dark undertone to that image there. So what is it? Slightly disappointing, maybe, but practical problem solving. Now, put to me, what is design thinking to me? Because this is how we work. It works pretty well. In the same vein as when I talked about the process diagrams there, there's no reason why you can't invent your own variant of this, and I'd expect you would. The context in your organizations, your applications, it makes such a difference. The idea that you can just pick a process off the internet and apply it directly is a nonsense, quite frankly. I also think the name is misleading. When it was conceived some decades ago, probably it suited better, the idea of coming together to come up with a thoughtful solution to a problem. Yeah, no problem with that. But we've got people now with design in their job titles, and that starts to confuse things slightly. So I'm head of design at Wyoming. We have user experience designers, user interface designers, solution designers, all fancy job titles, but there's no reason why anyone with those job titles would be better or worse than any of these others, or any whatever your job titles is. Just forget that idea. In fact, actually, I imagine that some or all of you are already doing some or all of this in this guise, in a different guise. That's great. If you are doing all of this stuff and you take nothing away, that's great, you're already doing it. So to try and describe what I think design thinking is, got this diagram here. And at Wyoming, we're typically trying to work in that center point there. What users want, which is what Macarena described, is typically get to A, from A to B as frictionless as possible. What's good for the organization tends to be something to do with commercial benefit, directly or indirectly. And then what can realistically be delivered? So these are your constraints. Could be in terms of data, you've got technical constraints, what data you can get, how often you can get it, how much of it you can get, what format you can get it in. But from a project level, you've got time, money, those sort of constraints there. And just trying to work in the center of that. So after criticizing process diagrams, I'm going to show you a process diagram. And again, what I want to do is eliminate as many buzzwords as I can, speak as plainly as I can, but also emphasize this point that you needn't take all of this and try and apply it. If there's just one tiny bit that you think is worthwhile, go for it. And the principle behind this is to do these things quickly, because although it might seem trite, focus less on being right and be good at being wrong. Now, probably like some of you, I find it very easy to be wrong. And a problem-solving technique which turns that into an advantage is good from my point of view. Trying to be right is stressful, difficult. It's not stressful or difficult at all, being wrong. And if you can do it fast, you will eventually get to being right. I thought a good visual illustration, it's not the perfect metaphor, but I think a good visual illustration of this are Harrison's clocks. I used to live just over the water from Greenwich on the Isle of Dogs, and in Greenwich they've got these on display. And I think it's a great example of how where you end up is not necessarily where you thought you were going to end up, or that journey in between. John Harrison was a clockmaker, and over the course of 20 years, with some help, he was trying to solve the problem of telling time at sea. Telling time at sea on a boat is difficult because you've got the natural movement of a boat with pendulum clocks. That's not a good mix. Also, extreme temperatures change how the metal works or behaves. And when you're trying to tell time accurately, you need precision. That's the difference between hitting a rock and not. I just thought that was a good visual illustration of this process, and hopefully it doesn't take you 20 years to solve your problem, but the principle is what's important. So when might you choose to use this sort of problem-solving technique? When you've got complex problems like the Harrison's clocks, there's very little you can do to emulate, or that John Harrison could do to emulate that scenario. Sticking it in a bath and leaving it overnight is really not going to get you a realistic experiment. When you've got broad use cases, for instance, you've got, I think Macarena hinted at it there or in the introduction, that you've got different users who want different things, but they're quite radically different things. When you want innovation and there's no off-the-shelf solution that's going to get you there, when there's lots of risk, and for that, it's this idea that turning up on the last day of the product of the project to the client or whoever you're working with, and having all your eggs in that basket to present that and say, ta-da, if it's wrong, that's just a high-risk approach. It's not particularly sensible. Team ownership, I think that's an underrated side of this as well. A lot of times I've worked with design or development departments that know nothing about their target audience, absolutely nothing. That's just not a great recipe for success, especially when you've got smart people, you want to use them. And even if they're not contributing to the solution, even just the understanding of the audience involved is a massive step up there. Likewise, difficult constraints, it's similar to high risk. So rather than spend any time going on the detail of these projects, these are some examples from IDEO, who are a design consultancy who helped to popularize design thinking. I wanted to call out two things. The first, that you've got a physical product, got a software product, and you've got a service. This sort of problem solving applies equally well across all of those. And those blue bullet points at the bottom there, just the sort of nugget of this sort of problem solving that's present there. Driven by patient research is understanding your audience. Informed by user behavior is treating your finished release product as a learning opportunity and then improving it. And the final one there, in this complex problem, far easier to just test, learn, and improve rather than try and anticipate all the problems and come to a solution that way. So how does this all apply to designing for complex data? You'll probably be aware of most of these. I think probably worth saying again, challenges when presenting that complex data. So too much information. When there's no distinction between what I was talking about earlier, the idea that you've got drastically different use cases, people are looking for different things. When there's no clear actions, the way I describe it to designers at Wyoming is that there's a difference between vomiting out data that you have on a page and providing some genuine insight. A lack of prioritization is very close to the information overload point there, showing a lot, but really no idea of prioritization. When you're showing data without context, so that's the idea of showing timeframes, this number that I'm seeing, is it a good number? Is it a bad number? What should it be? What's an acceptable range? All that sort of context. And especially when you convert it to some sort of interface, it can be misleading choices or a lack of consistency in the application of color, for instance, that just makes it a confusing thing to use. So most of those probably you're aware of, things you've encountered. When you don't take those things into consideration, you end up with examples like this. This slide is really an excuse for me to show that top left image, which might be my favorite software image of all time, an almost literal dashboard. Now, I respect that they had a vision and they stuck to it and they went for it and they've done it. But in terms of, and it's of our time as well, but in modern standards, the relevance of all that stuff around the information, the presentation of that information that has got nothing to do with a car, the scale of the interface there, for instance, the traffic light at the top right, it's quite difficult to then add a fourth, fifth, whatever. But I still love it. And what I'll say again to the designers quite a lot is it's very easy to get caught up in complexity and the sort of academic side of this, but really show the right data to the right people at the right time. It's a pretty simple principle. And to take you back to this process diagram, again, I'm big on this point of I want to give you something to take away that is actually useful and easy to apply in a commercial setting where changing process is hard, where getting time sometimes is hard. And I think actually this first step, and particularly in understanding the audience, that's the nugget there that, in my opinion, all of this comes out of. And it's the thing that we do most often to the start of every project. And that's where, I don't want to say the vast majority of the value is, but it's an easy target and an easy way to get value from this sort of process. So we've got four audience groups here. You can call them personas, for a fictional scenario that I've come up with for this presentation. Now, it is based on a real project we've done in pharmaceutical manufacturing, but I've had to simplify it a fair bit for the duration of this presentation. But I'm not trying to trivialize some of the data challenges that you're going to see because they're real, but just hope you appreciate that the benefit of what I'm talking about, or what I think the benefit is not in the detail. It's not about the specifics of this pharmaceutical manufacturing process. It's about how to apply the idea to any of your challenges. So we've got four different personas there. If you're at a point where you struggle to even write down this, then you're in quite a difficult spot. To me, the idea that you could produce a good end product that meets requirements of the users without knowing this information is that's a key concept to me. And if you can't get this information, then the thing I do is recommend speaking to people. Now, it could be that the person next to you knows that, or it could be that there is a manager that knows that. It could be that someone is in contact with the client, someone who's in contact with the end users, like sales or marketing departments. They can be quite good ones, especially in the B2B world, where it's sometimes quite difficult to get in touch with these people. If you were to try and produce a dashboard for those four different types of people, you might end up with something like this. And I don't think this is a great end product. In my opinion, it speaks to some of the challenges that I presented earlier. This idea that we've got no real prioritization at the start. We've got a mix of commercial information and production information, which is a bit unusual. We've got competing timeframes. We've got a rolling 24-hour, poorly styled chart with year-to-date, year-on-year, quarterly info, along with what looks like some up-to-the-minute sort of slider UI on the right, and some poor choice of pie charts with unreadable text down the bottom. Again, just an illustration of a few things, really just not considering those problems that we talked about earlier. So going back to those personas, what I want to do is start to break those down for you into more easily digestible chunks. That's going to get us more closely to understanding their pain points. So at the top left, this idea of use case, commercial and production, very different use case between these. And again, I don't want to go into the detail of the actual scenario that this was based on, because we'd be talking about pharmaceutical manufacturing for a couple of hours. But obviously the plant operator, if I simplify it, is really going to be concerned about what levers, what buttons, et cetera, the commercial director. The difference is obvious. I don't need to go into too much detail there. But also time frame of interest. What's happening up to the minute for the plant operator is obviously pretty important. For a commercial director, trying to equate those up to the second interactions to some sort of bottom line is not a particularly worthwhile exercise. It'd be incredibly difficult. You've also got the systems director there who needn't even be an actual user of the system, but they're absolutely going to be a source of constraints and feasibility when you're talking about what data is available, because he's the one with the keys to the data and the output. So we understand a little more about these different personas now. I want to zoom into the production supervisor, because I thought they were quite a nice example sat in between those two on the outside. And if you didn't have anything and now you've got this, you are one step better, but we can do a lot better than this. So what we like to do is look at this from the user point of view. And if you remember going back to those three Venn diagrams, this is this top one, understanding the user requirements. So what are the pain points they face? These are based on reality. Again, I don't want to go into too much detail, but what I'm trying to get at here is the idea of trying to understand what this user needs in order to improve their work scenario. And that's the first step, really, pain points, understanding the pain points. This is user-centered design. But then what you can do on top of that is look at one of those pain points, or look at all of them, and try and come up with solutions for them. And it's worth saying that in the real project that this was based on, the actual project really ended up, the entire project ended up being a solution to just one of those problems, and that was to understand the relationship between two metrics fundamentally. And again, I'm not trying to trivialize the problems when I put them up here, because you'll be looking up there and saying, actually, that's a pretty complex problem. And I'm aware of that. And in our case, making changes to the target metric relied on an incredibly complex system, tons of variables. And doing something in one place might have an effect on the output 3 weeks later. And then you've got so many variables in between, complex system. But it's this approach to trying to understand the pain points and coming up with solutions to real problems rather than starting from the technology end and saying, I'm great at X, so therefore, how can I shape X to be the solution? Other way around. One thing that we like to do as well is prioritize. And it's not something that's talked about a lot in design thinking, a bit more in agile. But it's this idea of prioritizing how important this persona is to the success of the project, but also the pain points as well. And this is going to become especially relevant because when you roll these up to the wider level, and again, this is simplified, you might have many more personas. You might have many more pain points for each persona, but it's a simplified example. But if you're starting to talk with managers or you are a manager in this project, it becomes very easy when you're looking at this to understand, given technical constraints, given commercial constraints, time, budget, where should you start? It's pretty obvious. So I go back to this slide again. I'm not worried, really, what you guys might think about what I showed you, because in however long I've been up here, I've just shown you that example. The whole point is that I don't really care if I'm wrong. If you guys want to slate it and say how bad it is, I would probably thank you for your constructive criticism, but then ask you what's better. That's the whole point that I'm trying to make here, is this be good at being wrong bit. I'm not worried about it being right, especially if you can start to validate that information with the actual people we're talking about. If you can speak to production supervisors, ask them if this is a real problem they face, you've got the format to speak to them. So if we were to approach that original problem differently, the one with the awful garish dashboard, what might we come up with? And I got someone at Wyoming to put this together. And the first thing that was done was a separation between the different personas. You can see at the top right, I mean, that's a simplified example for the sake of a presentation, but the idea that a single screen that's just for trying to deal with all of them in one scenario is much harder than separating them. We've got the idea of the production supervisor. So what you're looking to do is produce an interface that speaks to those pain points that you've identified. All good. I don't want to go into the specific details here of the actual data. And in a way, the immediacy of what's happening here is pretty ridiculous, actually. The chances of you being fine at 9 o'clock on a Monday morning, but then catastrophe like 12 hours later is unlikely. But I just wanted to get a point across. But the principle is that at the top, it's some information on what might be happening that is relevant to the pain point they faced. And it would have been easy for me to have a little button to the side of that which just said resolve and click that. But again, I didn't want to get the designer producing this to trivialize the idea of working in complex systems when that example I gave of having a few weeks lag between seeing that it's just not realistic. So what I asked them to produce was this idea that you're relying on the expertise of the user in producing this, the production supervisor. They might, in this example, look at what's happening on the left-hand side. The actual readings are sort of parroting back what's been messaged at the top. The predicted values show the potential danger of that. But on the right-hand side, a list of prioritized metrics that might be read from elsewhere in the plant that can inform them to make a decision. Yeah, if you can tell them exactly what's wrong and how to resolve it, fantastic. But that's not always possible, especially in more complex systems. Again, same thing. I don't mind what you think of what I just showed you. If you were to give feedback, it would have to be relevant feedback, and ideally it comes from the production supervisor's point of view, someone who deals with production supervisors or has knowledge of the domain. But that's the principle. Just iterate. Do that fast. Goes back to that same point that I made before, is it's far easier to be wrong 100 times and do that quickly than it is to try and put all your eggs in one basket, especially on high-risk projects or complex projects. Going back to this process diagram, I said I was going to focus on that first box, but what you'll see is actually in that example, we did the whole thing. We looked at understanding the audience, and through that, in conversation, you would probably find out about the constraints. Yes, you might identify that a pain point for one particular user, is especially valuable. But then you speak to someone else and they say, yeah, that's great, but that's just not feasible within time or budget. We don't have that data, whatever. And then through that, you're confirming those thoughts by talking to people. I came up with a solution, but there were two different levels of solution in that. There was solutions to individual pain points, and there was a solution at the dashboard, actual predicted graphic as well. And then we talked about sharing and improving that. Same process. So right at the start, I talked about wanting to try and give you some practical steps, and I didn't want to assume too much of where everyone was at this stage, how much value that you might find in what I was talking about. But if you are pushed for time but you want to try something, where I would recommend starting is with the audience and pain points. I feel like it's something that anyone can do. I think time boxing it to 30 minutes is a great idea, and because it forces you to do something. And it also gets you pretty quickly into this idea of not being afraid to show things to people. And it also, what's useful is it stops you investing a huge amount of time, i.e. money, in problems. So share the output of that, and then incorporate that feedback, ideally feedback from someone relevant, and then take another 30 minutes to come up with an idea for one of the pain points. Do the same there. It's not rocket science, this stuff. It is just repetition and awareness of complexity of the problems that you're being faced with. But literally anyone can do this. Okay. Now, hand over to Rob.
Thank you, Simon. Hi, everyone. I'm Rob. It is fabulous to be here. Real people in a real event space is, I think we've all missed this, so it's wonderful to be here. We've all seen, you know, the effect of digital tools becoming more and more prevalent through the pandemic, and it's been fantastic. As a digital first organization, we were already tooled up with digital collaboration tools, and making the transition was pretty easy for us. Not so easy for organizations that, you know, a power station, for example, you know, you need to be physically in the area. Now that we're starting to come out of the pandemic, touch something that's approximately wood. I just wanted to kind of sound a little note of caution about being too digital, particularly at certain key stages in projects. There are certain key decision points where it's much, much better to be in person. When you're doing project catch-ups, you're doing daily stand-ups, you've got 30 minutes, you've got 15 minutes, and you just want to knock off a few little points on an agenda. Are the teams resourced? What blockers are there? What progress have we made? Do we need to de-scope anything back to the backlog? Can we bring something forward? Those kind of things, digital tools, primo. Absolutely fantastic. When you start to do a project kickoff, however, when you're trying to do a workshop, I think that digital tools are the best available thing in a pandemic. But if you can, get out and meet people. Be with the people. And I think that that's one thing that we've missed at the kickoff to some of our projects over the past couple of years. And I don't want to slide too far back to relying only on digital tools. I'm sure a lot of you have heard this expression of Gemba, doing a Gemba walk, to walk the process. And I think it's an incredibly valuable experience. It's super interesting to people who are new to an industry or have come from an adjacent industry, to really understand what's happening in the place where value is created, to observe the real world, the real work being done. And it's very hard to do this digitally. The example that Simon mentioned was a we had a toxicity issue we're trying to solve for a client. And the plant was based in China, so not handy. But we had to rely on, it was right at the beginning of the pandemic, and we had to rely on shaky videos showing the site, and a large complex industrial site. You know, it's really difficult to take from a video show round what would be happening in situ. And some of the things that they were measuring data with, they had some sensor-based data acquisition methods, so they were getting, you know, real-time or near real-time signals. Other data measures were being taken with probes, so 4-meter-long probes being inserted into a vessel every hour, and a reading taken, whether that is dissolved oxygen, pH, temperature, whatever it might be. That measure is then written onto a clipboard, transcribed to Excel, because the world still runs on Excel, and then is sucked up into some larger modeling tool. But when you actually are in the real place, you find out that this plant in China, geographically, it ranges from really cold in winter to really hot in summer. And there are practical limits on applying this 4-meter probe into the carousels where the liquid was being processed. And I don't think that you get that as much digitally. So I think there is a real place for this. Some of the places where I've had the privilege of doing Gemba walks or walking the process, from spool yards for North Sea industry, a high-precision hi-fi maker, whiskey distillery. I think if you're a Scottish consultancy, it's actually compulsory that you have a whiskey client. That's just, you know, part of being Scottish. Working with a university and working with call centres that many organisations have. And you can get a data dump from those organizations. You can get process flows. But some of the unexpected pieces of data, information, experience that I was able to gain as we did the Gemba, a spool yard is unbelievably cold, noisy, and dirty. And it is, I didn't put this on the slide, it is the sweariest work environment I've ever been in, bar none. The hi-fi maker, I did not appreciate the work that goes into working aluminium components to fit precision hi-fi into. The way that solid blocks of aluminium were milled was just fascinating to see in person. The whiskey distillery, I discovered that because it's a craft industry, time is actually a variable. You know, I do a lot of work in pharmaceuticals and chemicals, and you know, time. You know, you don't just leave a formulation cooking and then, you know, kind of like, oh, I'll maybe have another cup of coffee and then have a look at the, you know, how the mix is going. Yeah, it kind of feels okay. I'll take it out. But that's what they do in the whiskey industry. There's kind of like a sense of feel of a personal connection with the maker and the made product, which I didn't appreciate so much until I went in there. And then working in a call center, investigating, doing process analysis, and figuring out the ins and outs of a call center, you know, there's a lot of social stuff going on in a call center. And, you know, the production metrics are measured, but there is a lot of boredom and a lot of mischief. And we discovered people using the call center to run their sideline drugs business. We also found that in the call center they had a lot of white male. So that is male that is not of a particular form. So it could be letters of complaint, you know, things like that. And one of the metrics that the organization was running was keeping the level of complaints month on month below a certain target metric. The team dealing with the white male felt so overwhelmed that their great solution for keeping under the metric is to shred complaint letters from the, you know, people find a way. And when a client sends us a dump of data or opens up a data connection to us to examine what they've got, you never get that kind of experience from it. So I love the digital tools. I've been in many collaboration exercises digitally, but I encourage everyone to, you know, once we can safely be out in the real world, be in the real world. And when analysts, people working with data, designers, programmers, when they can't... Okay, so that's digital. That's my Siri thinking that I have kicked off. Actually, just a quick side look. I work with a guy in California whose name is Surya, and it kicks off whenever I see his name on Zoom calls. You know, my watch just starts... can't find anything about that on the internet. Sometimes when you can't see the requirements clearly enough, you know, the data analysts, they don't need a larger scope of their view of the data. They need to shift perspective. They need to get out and understand how the work is done in the place where work is done. And the reason for doing all of this, better products with less waste. You know, so that's what you want to get. You want to be able to move fast. But when you kind of like you get into projects where you suddenly start discovering stuff, it's like little bits of information leach out of the walls, and you suddenly pick up 3 months into a project, there's another user group that hasn't been consulted, or there's a stakeholder who's not had a large enough voice, or there's another data feed that needs to be concluded. These are always problems of presentation as much as technical problems in a project. And you know, the less scrutiny you invite on a project so you can just get on and do the good stuff is generally a good thing. So better products with less waste. Now, the user perspective, Roslin Institute. I'm really sorry that Mazdak could not come because he is an impressive figure. He's impressive because he's the brainiest person that I know, and he's also a giant of a man. He is like super brainy Hagrid. He is a huge guy and just lovely, but he has come down with COVID, unfortunately. So I'm going to try and be mini Mazdak for a few minutes. And then I'm going to hand over to Simon, and we're going to kind of like bring it back to the stuff that we've been talking about, hopefully. So Roslin Institute up in Edinburgh at the University of Edinburgh. Large research facility, close to 600 people based up there at Roslin. And it's a fantastic facility. Out in the bucolic landscape just outside of Edinburgh. It's a wonderful facility. Lots of research, lots of work on genetics and genomics, and lots of problems with large data sets. They have a lot of data that they need to manage. One of the projects that Mazdak was involved in was a sheep gene expression atlas. So trying to figure out which parts of the body certain genes are expressed across different breeds of sheep. And trying to build all of this data into some kind of model that would help breeders, farmers, other researchers, a number of different users. And Mazdak and his team, we had the pleasure of working with them, not because we're genomicists, that's not an area of skill for us, but presentation of information to discrete blocks of users, that is a thing that we do. And we tried to help them through workshops to think about, you know, what are the different communities and what kind of data load might they need? How might you phase the information delivery over time or over different parts of projects? So this is you know, some of the kind of gene expression data that they're dealing with. So it's showing, you know, adrenal glands and kidney, medulla, and various parts of anatomy that I really don't understand. But MASDAQ would have given a really detailed explanation of this. But what I wanted to communicate here before I pass over to Simon is super large, complex data sets that need to be manipulated and presented in a way that is accessible for large numbers of different communities. So I think, Simon, take us through some of the persona work that we worked on.
Thank you. So hopefully this is looking quite familiar from what I talked about a few minutes ago. It's the idea of breaking down the audience groups to understand what their pain points are, and you've got prioritization at the bottom. And we look at things like where commercial advantage is gained and the different levels of expertise that the different users have, both academically and technically, in their ability to operate software. And this is a good example, following on from what I was talking about before, which was pretty broad, of how you should definitely feel like you can shape these techniques to whatever you're working on. The idea of picking just a default persona off the internet and applying it, I mean, it might work, but it's not optimal. So you can see these building up here. We've got the undergrad student, we've got outreach, we've got postgrads, young farmers. What's starting to be interesting at this point is that we're dealing with both internal and external users. This is not something that I talked about in my piece earlier, but absolutely personas can be both internal to the business or whatever your organization is, and external users of an application. Just because someone is not using the application itself or whatever, consuming the data, that doesn't mean that their pain points aren't real and won't have an impact on the product or project. So in my example before, it was the idea of the technical director, major source of constraints. If you don't take those into consideration, you're onto a loser. So we've built that up with also the breeding R&D scientist and pharmaceutical R&D to try and get the industry side of things. It's really just building up this picture of knowledge for Roslin, working directly with them. And as Rob said, when you employ these techniques, you don't need to know the science. It helps to understand enough to be able to make good decisions. But our job in this process is not to understand the science. It would be stupid for us to try and take the place of MASDAQ, because he just knows so much. It would be dumb. But what we can bring is structure to this process to take this sort of nebulous problem and turn it into something that we can actually achieve in a reasonable time frame. When you start to factor in the commercial and technical constraints, then that also starts to get the attention of sort of academic advisory boards who are interested in how long it's going to take to achieve stuff. You've got to put time and money against these things. It's just the reality of how the world works. And here, another example of how you can change this depending on your different needs, change this process. So here we've got the idea of technical competence, expert and novice on the side, versus also importance to the project and project success. And again, when you're talking about constraints and you're talking about a roadmap, this helps you to identify both the contrast in experience that they're going to need, but also in terms of their importance to the project and for prioritization and things like that. So all this is happening in a sort of early stage of the project where we're just trying to understand what the problem is. And I said before I didn't want to get too hung up on the buzzwords, which is why I hesitated there. But if you were to contrast this with something like an agile methodology, which there's lots of crossover. I know Agile is more typically associated with software, but that sort of methodology tends to be about narrowing down the number of solutions that are on offer and coming to a conclusion. But what we're talking about here is almost the opposite. It's trying to ask questions and increase your options and understand everything before you then go and make decisions. I hope that made sense. So next steps for us would be to help with producing a proof of concept. And you see some of these bullet points should echo what I was talking about before we move towards this MVP design. But it's just work closely with subject matter experts. That's your validation piece. produce some custom data visualization. That is your prototype. That is your test, your solution. And then just these minor points here. It's just this regular client contact, regular user contact, regular stakeholder contact. Okay. Is that good? Or we all go?
Okay, well, thanks to Sam Rob for that. That was really very interesting indeed. Lots to think about. So I'm Paul Watson. I'm the director of the National Innovation Centre for Data. So welcome. So we've now got about 20 minutes or so for questions. Now, Rob was making the point about it's good to be face-to-face and in person, go back to the old ways of working. So you can actually, if you want to, do things like put your hand up and shout out a question. If you prefer, there's a Slido. And if I get this right, then let me just check on my... Thanks, Alison. Somebody got the clicker?
Yeah.
There we are. So if you don't want to put your hand up and read it out, then there's Slido is at www.slide.do. And then the key thing is that code. So 002222. And we'll have to remember we have to go to a different code for the next part of the afternoon. But by all means, if you come to a Slido, then do ask us some questions there. So I'll keep an eye on it on here. But first of all, what questions does anybody have?
No, very similar. I think part of the difference, not a great answer, but part of the difference is that Agile is so closely associated with software development still. I know people do use it for other things. So that in itself is a difference because Agile hasn't really grown out of software in the same way. That's one difference. But also I feel like most people's experience of Agile comes when a lot of the project's already been decided. In a development cycle, for instance, most of the work before a developer gets involved has been decided, really. You're talking about implementation changes. Yeah, you might be talking about how a UI might be built to solve a specific problem, but really the business problem central to that has been decided a long time ago. And you do get, like, in continuous improvement, you're going to get topics come up where you're really involved in coming up with new features, and some of that comes into it there. But for me, where this is a bit different is that it shifts towards being more about, I hinted at it right at the end there, this idea of asking more questions and trying to understand the problem more fully than just how can we get to a solution, which is sort of, in data terms, it would be not just jumping straight to the data and trying to solve that rather than understand the problems in the user base. But there's a lot of crossover, and that's why at the very start what I wanted to say was that for a lot of you, there might not be anything new in this. You might be doing some or all of this already, and that's great. But for those that aren't, to feel that understanding the audience and all that piece there, if there's value in that, then great. I hope that answers.
Could you like a bit about the personas of the people that you're giving data to as well, and the input about things that are like
good.
Thank you. Yeah,
okay. Sure. Yes, just want to get some ideas of the knowing that you have to develop a different persona? And that's the first question. And the second question is, you want to be able to discover new things from data rather than giving a piece of information to people that are expecting to see something. How do you cross that boundary in where the data itself becomes a discovery tool rather than just a piece of information?
Can I go first?
Yeah.
I think the timescale of the project, it was approximately 5 to 6 months, but I would describe that as elapsed time rather than 5 to 6 months of a team of three people heavily working on it. But moving from, you know, what does gene expression mean to what does gene expression mean for different communities to how can we start thinking about proofs of concept and mocking some stuff up, getting the data pipelines set up to support that. That was probably a 4 to 6 month project. And in terms of the second part, as I understand it, trying to look for a problem, I think that the example of the manufacturing plant in China, pharmaceutical manufacturing plant, they had a way of dealing with toxins, and that was to reduce the flow rate going through the plant, and it allowed their treatment plant to kind of catch up, and they would eventually solve the problem. The toxins would come down to an acceptable parts per million level, and then they would start to ramp up production. But it was a little bit of an unsophisticated solve for their challenge. So they wanted to look into the data, and the first thing that we found was there were too many data measures, and many of them were not contributing to the actual problem. So narrowing down the scope, the dimensionality of the problem, and then we looked for techniques, and we settled on one. It just occurred to me the technique that worked best. It's called MACD. I thought that was a nice symmetry with NICD, and it really was a kind of trial and an error process of moving modeling forward to try to get a little bit more insight, a little bit more understanding, and to separate out the understanding to machine operators, plant planners, and executives, because you know there are people who are literally turning dials for distilled water or temperature or you know things like that that need very different measures to am I compliant with the Chinese Environmental Protection Agency parts per million standards.
Need to go for that?
Yeah, go for it. Please.
So, I think I remembered all of the question. The constraints of a project, which I think is what's getting hinted at quite a lot there, that's one of those three Venn diagrams that I was talking about there. And really, I would be lying if I said there was one single thing that worked all the time. But in regular client, or for us, regular client contact in dealing with those different variables. It's through that regular prioritization that, I'm trying to think of a better way to say it, that all those problems effectively go away because you are regularly, if it's not daily, a few days between each or weekly, reprioritizing, and that's similar to the agile world. Constantly reprioritizing, constantly looking at the constraints, constantly trying to balance that with the pain points that you have hopefully validated with people that are in the client project so that everyone appreciates who we're designing this thing for, what's important for them, everyone agrees. Those sort of problems that you typically get on more waterfall style projects, just hesitate a little bit to say that because they're not mutually exclusive. Those things where you get to the end of a project and you're like, you didn't say that, that's completely changed, complete change of scope. the risk of those things happening lessens far more when you're just in regular contact. And I'd love to pretend that it was some sort of golden process, but it's not. It really, at the centre of it, is communication and just talking. That's not a particularly insightful answer, but it does work. I mean, we rarely have those type of problems. Sometimes they come up, right? There's just changes in constraints, changes in scope, but just going through the regular communication, regular reprioritization of stuff, it tends to help with that massively.
If I could build just very quickly, I think one of the things that's successful for us on projects is momentum. It seems like such an obvious thing to say, but kind of nothing succeeds like success. And when you're managing stakeholders, if the project scope is big and complex, and you're trying to satisfy multiple stakeholders, then you know risk profile is going like that. Time scales to when you can prove your worth as a project team push out. So what we like to do to you know as consultants, as advisors, as third-party builders, what we like to do is to get something that we can deliver and physically vest that says, you know, this is good. We're on a pathway and we're building towards something. And identifying that, what you can get out into production, and it might be reduced scope, reduced number of audiences, minimal data scope, but it's something that's out in the real world and it proves that the journey is worth taking the next step. I think momentum is critical on projects, particularly when you've not done something like it before. You know, it's a confidence builder in the project team and around the organization.
Can I also add one thing to that? It just made me remember something. And it's the idea that, especially for us, the talking side of things, it's a bit like what Rob was talking about with the Gemba walks. It's an uncomfortable reality, this idea that doing these things where you have to get up and go to this place and talk to people versus the comfort of being able to sit at home, get files, look through them, and be in control of everything. A lot of the value that on some recent projects as well that people are seeing from us is our ability to help talk and connect different people. And especially in big organizations, there's historical problems between departments where just over time, communication's broken down, that's become the norm. It's not aggressive in any way, it's just that's how it is. Development doesn't talk to product, whatever. And so the value in people, and it's uncomfortable. You come into data or you come into software wanting to write code. You don't necessarily want to go in because you want to talk to people. But still, that is just so valuable, being able to problem solve in that way and connect people. People do really value it.
There's a question on Slido that a lot of people are interested in, which I think might follow on from this, which is how much education is needed for clients to buy into design thinking before a project starts? Do you start off by doing something like this, where you teach them what design thinking is, or do you just launch yourself into the project with them?
I don't talk about it at all. I just say this is how we're gonna work, and in part a lot of it's just handled with the meeting cadence in a 3-6 month project, whatever it happens to be. The meeting cadence kind of informs it, and you're building the project around the meeting cadence. You know, like if you're having weekly meetings, it's pretty hard. Well, if you're having daily meetings, but it's pretty hard not to have that constant communication. So that's driving it, but I mentioned that I'm quite pragmatic and not very academic. I'm sure there is a way of talking about these things and presenting them in that way, but I don't at all. Just build it into the schedule as meeting. This is how we work. We're going to show you and involve you in the process. For the client, they tend to be happy to be involved. And for us, a purely selfish point of view, you're getting people invested in the process as it's developing. And that tends to end up in less wastage, better end product, but it also massively reduced the chances of someone turning up at the 11th hour and saying, that's completely different to what I asked, because there's tons of micro decisions that have led up to that they've been involved with, and it does still happen, but
it's
rarely.
It's not a big reveal.
Exactly.
A lot of the sort of knowledge transfer happens by osmosis within the project, the collaborative project teams, rather than having a formal, you know, right, before we kick off our project, we're going to tell you what design thinking is. We kind of self-select projects that we're going to be a good fit for. Mm-hmm. And when we describe the approach to buyers, they're either, you know, that's great. We know all this stuff. I want more regression. Can you just give me, you know, if you've got like a big box of regression that you can bring? We tend to kind of self-select away from those, where there's a little bit more uncertainty, a little bit more willingness to say, we appreciate that we've got a problem and we'd like some help to solve it. And by osmosis, by doing that kind of investigation, by doing that research, by trying things, by breaking things, doing something else, breaking that, trying again, it kind of seeps out beyond the project team. And I think it becomes an accepted way. And particularly to go back to the earlier question, releasing value early and demonstrating the pathway and building momentum is very successful.
Thank you. And Tanea, I think you had a question.
I think it's partly answered now, but I can ask you more. So how do you take into account the fact that maybe like different personas might not embrace the solution equally, or is it just left to the organization to handle it internally?
Question.
There's a balance point between, as a project team, whether that is a hybrid internal-external team, it's internal or it's external. As the project team, there is a charter, formal or informal, about what your role is in the organization. And you have to involve yourself with the social organization, the political organization, but it's tricky territory trying to influence the social and political organization. Being sensitive to it, for sure, but I think where we kind of draw the line is we're invited to come into an organization and we can start to show a journey. We can give advice, and Part of the fun of being a consultant is being able to offer advice. The hard part about being a consultant is seeing your research and your advice not taken. But your job immediately after that is to then slap on a cheerful face and say, okay, you know, we think it's route A. You want to go route B? That's cool. Our job is to execute route B to the best of our ability, and that's what we try and do. And I think trying to win battles that we shouldn't really be fighting as a project team is beyond the scope of what we should be.
Just going to add to that, there was a project before Christmas, and it was a two-parter. I think you'll recognize what it was. And it was run internally on client side. It was improvements to customer support mechanisms for something. They didn't involve enough stakeholders. A lot of this is going to sound like I'm drifting away from the design thinking stuff, but really it's because I'm going towards the project management side of things. Those three diagrams, that's the basic project management, right? And they didn't consult enough people. They didn't understand their audience well enough, and they did that, ta-da, big reveal, too late on. It was wrapped up in the guise of looking for feedback, but too much had been decided that high up in this customer care team, which was a significant division, they just pushed back on it and killed a thing that had been running for three, four months. And then they came to us and started again effectively, and we started speaking with them from the beginning. Now, I don't want to make out like it was all us. I think in part that they'd been consulted and this prior relationship breakdown had been resolved immediately, probably a big part of the success factor. But just involving them, I think, I don't know if it was you or someone had a call with them, and they said, oh, what, you had a call with the customer care team, and they loved you? It's like, well, what is this? Just by virtue of the same thing, talking, trying to minimize risk, involving the right people, trying to make them feel like their points were being heard, and then translating the constraints of the project to them in talking to them so they understand that the things that they're asking for in the context of the project right now might not be achievable. It's basic project management stuff, but it does also link onto what I was talking about before. That's an uncomfortable reality. If you want to work in that world, talking to people and being able to understand the constraints and manage that relationship, amazing skill to have if you can also do that and be a production person. You become so valuable.
Question at the back.
Just wondering, when you're speaking with stakeholders about like constraints that you might have with like time or capacity, have you got any advice on how to persuade them to go in a certain direction, or whether or not, like, say they wanted a certain amount of data points, but some of those data points historically aren't actually vital? How do you convey that?
I wonder if some of it's linked towards the quick wins side of things, is that if you can demonstrate value early, then that builds your credibility, especially if you can do that quicker and cheaper than they thought previously possible. I know it's a long game, but you've demonstrated your value pretty quickly. In for us, commercial terms are really the way we do that. Certainly long term, I think that makes life easy.
I don't want to give the impression that I've only ever worked on one project, because I have actually done other things, but I'm going to go back to this China plant again, because it illuminates a useful example for this question, I think. One of the challenges that we had was incomplete, every project has got imperfect data, but they really had some poor data being originated. And they had problems with transcription. They'd a lot of data quality issues. They had data collection, data management issues. And we worked the first iteration with best available information. But one of the things that we recognized was things like, they had these very large 6 meter deep carousels, and there is mixing going on and a critical level of dissolved oxygen to keep populations of bacteria healthy. The mixing, the rheology of those things was not being measured accurately, because it relied on someone putting a 4 meter probe into different parts of the carousel. And this was a task that was not well liked. It was difficult. It was you had to literally get into the carousel, and there's fumes coming out of the carousel. So what we recommended for a phase two was investing in inline meters. So these would be detectors sitting within the mix product that can pick up levels of dissolved oxygen at multiple depths in the program to say, so here's what we can do today. This is the best that we can give you today. And it's giving you early warning of rising levels of toxins, but we can do better. And here's what we'd recommend you do as a next step. You move into automated data collection, drawing the data signals directly into the model, rather than having manual measurement, transcription, and errors, delays, et cetera, et cetera. And that was well received in that particular organization.
I think we've got 2 minutes, so I think I should pick one of the highly liked questions from Slido to end with. For those people who prefer to use Slido. So, and I think this is for Simon. So Simon, you showed us a fantastic dashboard, which I quite like, actually, the one that looked like it was in a car.
Yeah.
So, and you said you weren't a fan of that, but the question is, what visualizations would you recommend?
For that specific, use case.
Well, let's start with that one, yeah.
Yeah. That's probably where I start, is that the short answer is I don't know, because that use case I think is marketing automation. Who's the audience for it? What are their pain points? And then I'll figure out trying to solve it. It's very difficult. I mean, it's not difficult. It's very easy to give an opinion on something that's completely uninformed. You can put anything in front of me and I can force myself to have an opinion on whether specific UI choices are good or bad, or whether maybe you could do some small minor improvements, but to make sizable improvements and suggestions to something like that, I just have to go back to the start. Until I know who the audience is, what their pain points are, and what the constraints of the project are, it's very difficult for me to have anything but a surface level view.
Yeah. So you've got in your head this range of different ways to visualize things, presumably for different sorts of data. For categorical data, there's this set of ways to do it. For numeric data, time series data, there's this way to do it. And by working with the clients, you come to a decision about what's the best way to present
on the specific UI used.
Yeah.
In short, so a lot of it just comes down to experience. There's so many. There's so many libraries of UI, and the number of times that I've heard someone say, let's use D3 for this. Again, it's this idea of just starting with the solution rather than the problem. But also in a lot of cases, that aside, simple things in a lot of cases tend to be better and more easily understood than complex visualizations. And in a way, if you feel like you need to come up with complex visualizations, the one I did in the improved dashboard was borderline complex for me, not massively complex, but if you're having to rely on really complex visualizations for data, you may want to take a couple of steps back and think how you can do that in a simpler way, and whether it's actually solving the problem or whether it's just a, choosing my words carefully, conscious this is being recorded, my natural way of talking, is that you don't want to do something just for the sake of it.
No. Okay, all right. Thanks to you both for that. Okay, so thanks cool. to the audience. So now we go into the bit I've been looking forward to the most, perhaps the interactive hands-on workshop.
This next section is all about the wisdom of the crowd. Hello, crowd. And you get a chance to provide some feedback to drive where the demo goes and make some choices, and hopefully you will come up with a good solid answer. And Macarena is just going to set up a new Slido, and the more people that participate, there are five questions, that's all. There's five questions and they're all A, B choices, and apart from one of them, the choices are there are compromises to be made, and you kind of have to choose the least bad option. And quite often in our work, that's what we're doing. You know, the very best option is sometimes out of reach, and it's selecting the least bad to just edge the project forward and edge the project forward. So we're going to try and do this with the questions over here, and we'll take the...
Actually, the events code is, well, I don't know if you can see that from there, but it's 70678180, so it's on the top. It's a bit small, but I can use.
Oh, yeah, it's up in the center of the blue bar at the top, 678180. So... would love as many people as possible to give options. Like I say, it's a low effort. Five questions that we're going to throw up. I'm going to do a little bit of intro to the challenge and talk around the problem. It's a problem that we're all familiar with. I guarantee. Everyone has experienced this in this room multiple times through the pandemic. It will be pretty obvious once we get into it. We good?
Yes.
Cool. Right. First of all, I'm going to start off with a really complex piece of user interface design. Now, this is a tool from Salesforce. It's relatively new module that they've released, High Velocity Sales, and it's mainly for inside sales teams in large organizations to kind of automate a lot of their processes. But as you can see, there is a lot in the interface. That is a high burden interface. So it assumes a high level of training. Now, I'm not making a value judgment about it that, you know, complex bad, simple good. Just saying that that is a high burden interface and you need a lot of onboarding experience to be able to use that. Any of us come to that fresh, we're going to struggle to understand, you know, how we go along. There's four columns of data. Within three of the columns, there are multiple panels of information, and it's not clear which are the most important, and it's not clear what I do next. So it requires a large amount of familiarization before you're effective. So no judgment. It's successful for large corporate inside sales teams, but you need to know a lot before you can use it. So the wisdom of crowds and a bit of a demo. So over the pandemic, I am sure every single one of us has had multiple packages delivered to our home, and we've received emails and text messages from the organization sending it out. And we've had the driver, rather than getting a signature, taking a photograph of the package at the doorstep. So we're all familiar with how that happens. But behind the scenes, there is a large amount of data orchestration that needs to fall in place for the driver to arrive at the correct place at the correct time. And all the planning that goes into it, multiple participants, lots and lots of data, and lots of segmented views of the data. So there are different persona, and they require and need different things from the data. We've got two things that we're trying to optimize for. Customer experience, abbreviated throughout this as CX. So by customer experience, that is, if I get the package when I'm advised, the 1 hour window that I see on my email the day before, the customer experience metric is delivering a very high percentage within that 1 hour window. That's the first metric that we're trying to optimize. The second metric is greenhouse gas emissions. So this is a diesel fleet of trucks. And if you've seen delivery drivers going around cities with the right foot very active on the accelerator running around cities, you will know that there is a way to drive a truck that is favorable to greenhouse gas emissions and less favorably. So those are the two metrics that we're trying to optimize and run through a scenario. Eight possible trucks that are going to go out on this for this fleet to deliver some packages to consumers. The customer experience target, get as close to 100% as possible, but not below 95% achievement of that 1 hour window. And greenhouse gas emissions target, they have an allowable budget for emissions each day. What is the actual value in kilograms of emission? I just thought it was too complex to you know, we can model it, but just for this demo, I've simplified it to a percentage. So 100% is your budget for today. We want to try and stay below 100% and not breach the budget. We've made loads of assumptions. This is a simplified environment. We've tried to take out some of the detail for the purpose of illustration, some of the things here. So we're not dealing with installation or setup. We're not dealing with safe places or neighbor delivery and all the kind of like the wrinkles that get added to it. There are also some constraints. So we're we're just trying to make the problem manageable in this little setting. Now, I've deliberately shown you, you know, Simon is curling his toes at the look of this particular slide right now, but I've made it deliberately small so that you can't figure out which combination and permutations is going to get you to the right answer. But I promise you, there is a combination of choices that we can make as the wise crowd to get to an optimal level of those two metrics. First of all, let's look at the participants. Who's in our story? So we've got five particular individuals that we're representing. They're representing roles, so there might be one operations director, but there might be many drivers. And just to call out, this section at the bottom, everything is driven from a common data store. So they all have access in one way or another to a common data store. We have an external organization user. We have potentially a third party individual. And we've got internal roles to the organization. But in one way or another, they're sharing access to a common data platform or data store. And they have, if you could distill down the need state of each of the persona to a little point, the customer, they want notifications, alerts and notifications. That's the key piece of information. They're not interested in route planning software. That's irrelevant to them. The driver wants directions, and he wants directions in a particular way to say, you know, I've delivered to 14 High Street. How do I get to 23 railway cuttings as fast as possible? You know, what's my best route to it? And the order of release of that information of the whole route to the driver is something of interest, and how sat-nav systems work. If you've ever sat in an Uber car or driven by an Uber driver and watched their display coming up, they don't say, you know, take the third on the left and then the second on the right, continue for half a mile, take another right, 2 miles, take a left. That data is in the application somewhere, but the phasing of the release is of interest in this particular set. Oops, sorry. The production scheduler, they have possibly the hardest job in this little scenario, and they have to figure out how to get 400 packages out to the customers via 8 vans in changing circumstances across the city. An analyst, QA analyst, data analyst, whatever, they've probably got a very different view. The driver is interested in what's next, where do I go next? The production scheduler is everything on track? Are all my trains running on time? The data analyst is looking at things and saying, well, you know, what have I learned about today when there was a car crash? What have I learned today about when we've got a cluster of deliveries over here? What have I learned what happens when it rains and we've got a really heavy delivery schedule? What have I learned that I can incorporate into models to make things better? But the detail of what's happening day by day, turn by turn, zero interest. And the ops director is month on month, week on week, year on year data, you know, high level metrics. The day to day, minute by minute feeds into that. But you don't want the ops director running around the warehouse saying, you know, where's the package for Mrs. Miggins? Have you got that on van 4? You know, where's van 7? You know, that's not what anybody wants. So the first part of the story, route planning. 400 packages delivered for today, 29th of March. How are we going to make that happen with 8 trucks running 8 separate routes? So what we've done is we've tried to sketch out mini persona definitions, try and bring a little bit of color to each of the participants. We've broken into their responsibilities, their priorities, and their view of the data, just to give it a little bit of context and a little bit of depth, adding a bit of color to it. And I'm not going to read out everything. You know, you can have a look. But for the production scheduler, their view is all deliveries for current day, route plan for each driver. What happened yesterday when, you know, truck four was late, that is gone. You know, it's like the penalty kick mentality. You know, you miss a penalty kick, that is gone. It's the next penalty kick that you're focused on. They're interested in the current plan. So we've mocked up this city with distribution depot. So that's where the trucks are going to leave from, and they have a series of points that they're going to visit. The production scheduler is trying to figure out, using route planning software, what is the best way to send my fleet of trucks to get around this, managing several constraints. The two that we're interested in, CX and greenhouse gas emissions, but they also have constraints, things like working time directives and, you know, balancing shift duration and, you know, personnel stuff that they need to manage. You know, you can come up with a route planning software that says, okay, if driver three runs for 17 hours, then I can get everything done. But that's probably going to risk some, you know, other metrics falling off the cliff. They may have access to some kind of dashboarding tool, some kind of modeling tool that gives them some insight where they can start to play around with some of the variables. So variables like traffic, like weather, where you're getting, you know, you know, in Britain, trying to figure out what the weather's going to be like next Tuesday is, you know, kind of like, you know, even tomorrow's a, you know, a little bit risky. It's real-time data that you need, or near real-time predictive data that you require. But they can kind of like maybe speculate some things. So there's controls at the bottom where they can say, well, you know, the forecast is medium level rainfall, approximately 130. You know, can I make an adjustment to the model? And I'll see if my current dispatch plan is going to breach 100 for the trucks, which is my greenhouse gas emissions target. So they might play around with a tool like that and start modeling it. And every day is a fresh start because the package delivery scenarios are different. You know, it's 400 packages today to these consumers, not 412 to those consumers. So they might adjust the model and see where it goes. The same map, the same depot, but overlaying some expected rainfall patterns. And how does that impact the particular routes? So you can see the heavier rainfall is further away from the depot. So, you know, how does that incorporate into the plan? How much allowance do we need to do? And you can see, as I click, you know, you change these values, and then you maybe get a higher level. But you know, this is reality that they've got to work with. So, considering all data, establish a route plan for truck number four. So, for the production supervisor, saying, right, okay, we're going to leave the depot, and then we're going to go up this way and, you know, around the city. The driver may have some awareness of where he's going to go across the city, but that data load is no use to the driver. It's great for the production scheduler, no use for the driver. And the customer doesn't care. Customer cares, you know, about, you know, number one, and that's it. So challenge number one, is that the right code?
The right code is on the left. Sorry about that. We needed to do a last minute.
So we're really good at data. So the code that you need is 678180. And the AB question is, you know, we've got this scenario. Should we risk impacting customer service by delaying some customers to the next day, or add to greenhouse gas emissions by running an extra route? Run one truck for second, or push back some deliveries. So you can't get a perfect answer. You have to pick, you know, the least bad option. So whatever you go for. Okay. Very good choice, crowd. Very good choice. So let's add a little bit of a real-world complexity into the scenario. Once you've sort of made your plan for the day, you then start getting ready for dispatch. Get the trucks out onto the road, start the schedule, and what kind of things are going to happen? Well, mechanical failure is something that can be partly offset by good maintenance routines, and a lot of environments have got really sophisticated modeling for preventative maintenance. Sometimes mechanical electrical systems break, and today truck 8 is non-operative, so we need to figure out a solution for going around the city. We've still got 400 packages to deliver, still got all the customers to serve. How are we going to make that happen? So one of the things that we could do, wait for excuse me, did I say the truck broke down? My bad. Sorry. Undo. So we've had a pick error. Excuse me, different scenario. We've put the wrong stuff onto one of the trucks, or we've mixed up packaging, and they need to resolve that, and there's a delay. So it might only be one or two packages, but it impacts the whole truck. The truck can't leave until that's resolved, or the truck goes and we disappoint. So your choice here is, should the originally scheduled truck wait 40 minutes, resolve the picking error, and then go? Or do we go right now and delay two of the packages? Ooh, split vote. Cool. So we've elected to try and pick up the meet the delivery requirements, but accept that there's a delay to some of the packages. Cool. Thinking about the driver experience. So again, we've done a little pencil sketch of Romeo, our designated driver for one of the trucks. Responsibilities, priorities, and their view of the shared data. Schedule for the current day, next destination, turn-by-turn navigation, and accurate address information. The key information for the driver is, where am I going right now? You know, do I turn left, do I turn right? It's sort of interesting where I might be going later in my route, but what I actually need right now is, where do I go right this second? So back to the map, there's the yellow truck, and do they go straight on, or do they go to the right? And the tools available for scheduling this in the cab, the production scheduling team, you know, they might see a much wider view of the data, but this is the kind of information that needs to be released to the driver at that time. In their current context, they need the turn-by-turn navigation. It's shared data store servicing multiple options. So, yet more complexity within the route that is going to affect potentially how we treat emissions and how we treat customer service. So again, you can't predict traffic light failures. You can model for scenarios where there may be traffic delays or crashes or roadworks or things like that. You can model for it, but you can't necessarily predict a particular traffic light failure with any degree of accuracy. But this is what happened in our scenario, and there will be time impacts for some of the trucks because that is near to their route. So do we accept a 15-minute delay, wait for slow traffic to clear, then proceed, or try and take an alternate route. And these handheld devices, these in-cab devices, are really good at finding alternative ways around it by working the data, not just finding a route that is going to get them to the next place, but then remapping the route if required. So what do you think? Do we take route B? Seems that we do take route B. This is cool. I have to say, the way this is shaping up, very wise crowd. Very wise crowd. So let's meet Mrs. Miggins, owner of Mrs. Miggins Pie and Coffee Shop. Reference hit home to anyone? Yes, yes, thank you. So this is the customer, and all the data planning tools, all the route planning tools, no interest, and no access. You know, it's an external user. So zero access and zero interest. What they want is their data view, single delivery slot and notifications, priorities, right first time, on time, every time. That's what the customer needs. That's what we all expect. I've had the email the previous day between 2:30 p.m. and 3:30 p.m. I've had the text message, Romeo, your driver will arrive at 3:15. So that is the delivery day. So at some point, the modeling tool has developed confidence in Romeo's schedule to say, I can now narrow the time to 3:15. And, you know, I'm sure we've all had variants of those, whichever courier tracking system we've used. Some of them will let you click through on a link. You might be able to find something on a URL that maybe gives you a little bit more information, but we're just simple text messaging. So, Mrs. Miggins Pie and Coffee Shop at 23 Railway Cuttings is going to be impacted by rain, and the traffic, the weather, real-time data feeds that can impact what's happening. An interesting point that I've just put down here on the bottom of the chart. Whilst the driver, once they've moved past a particular drop, the data about that drop, it's kind of like that's gone. But that data is potentially useful. It's a gift that can keep on giving for the data team, for the analysts, because the more data that you see, the more times you see rain impacting journeys, traffic failures, crashes, traffic lights, bottlenecks, slow traffic, whatever it is, the more you see of that, the more you're able to say, actually, it's not going to be 3:15, it's going to be 3:20, or it's going to be, you know, whatever. You get better and better input to the modeling data. So different people can use that data in different ways. But for Mrs. Miggins, the only thing that's of interest to her is not that the modeling tools will be uprated for, you know, next month, but that the delivery is going to be a little bit later. So another challenge, heavy traffic near railway station, what to do? Put up with the traffic and accept slower progress or adapt route? Again, balancing greenhouse gas emissions and customer experience. You know, what is the least bad choice? A hundred percent voting to avoid the railway station. That is comprehensive endorsement of that particular strategy. Cool. QA analyst, again, a little sketch of someone working with data, and their priorities are very different to the people that we've seen before. So the production scheduler, the driver, the customer, it's very much in the moment. The QA analyst is much more about looking back through time across journeys between different points in the city to see what the data can tell them. What's the story in the data? And how can I apply that to improve service, reduce emissions further into the future. So their view of the system, they might be writing code and they might be working directly onto the data. Very different view to other users, other participants in the storyline. So our final challenge, and this is a tough one. Heavy rain falling impacts all vehicles, particular impact to some of the vehicles, but what's the right choice? Drive faster in the rain to catch up, overtake when not safe, and look at your mobile, that's an option, or exercise caution and restraint, accepting difficult conditions. What's the right? Ah, interesting, 7% said drive faster. Okay, you psychos. So our final participant in this environment, this mock-up, the final participant that we sketched out a description for, a persona, is the director of operations. And the fact that there are rain delays, that there might not be perfect delivery of packages to the customer base on any particular day is, you know, disappointing, but it's not a critical point in their day. They are not going to take the two dropped packages into the back of their car and scoot out and try and deliver them to the customer. That would be nuts. What they are trying to do is to set the resourcing, the processes, the procedures, so that they get better in the future. So their view of the data, they're looking for key metrics. You know, are we tracking forward? Are we going backwards? Has our new modeling tool improved our delivery schedules? Are we, you know, we're tasked with a year-on-year 3% decrease in greenhouse gas emissions. Am I on track to hit that target? So their view of the data is quite different, and they're looking at overall metrics, long-term metrics, year-on-year, month-on-month, that kind of thing. So they may have some kind of performance tracker like this, and it's sucking up the data from lower levels. So the individual route journeys, the individual delivery instances, all of that aggregates up to give them a better view. Looking back through time, you know, back to October, you know, a six-month view in this particular setting. And to contrast with the view that I showed at the beginning, the Salesforce.com high-velocity sales interface, where there's a lot going on, some of the things that we do on a regular basis to try and improve accessibility, trying to improve the onboarding burden of information interfaces, is to try and use design a little bit carefully. So things like making objects within the bars into clickable objects so that you can bring one up and you can see a little bit more information. And that's one of the things about, you know, what I think of as good practice in information sharing is progressive release of complexity. Not kind of like going, bleh, here's everything that we know, but waiting for the user to engage with something and then surfacing a little bit of information. So you can see that there is a filter, show previous year, a little slider that you can put from, you know, no to presumably yes. Pretty obvious what that does. The bar that you've clicked on, just so that you're aware, the color has changed. You know, there's just a little subtle use of color to remind you that that's the one that you've clicked on, and it gives you some additional data in the view. You'll notice on there's a little plus symbol hugging the browser edge, and it's sometimes referred to as a side drawer. And you tap the side drawer, and it brings out perhaps a configuration option. So it's filtering options in this particular case. But when you don't need that data, that functionality, it's out of the way but easily accessible. So you kind of bring things into view as the context of the user might shift around. So they can kind of like play with that. And these kind of adaptable interfaces, You'll notice also that the display element darkens as the side drawer comes out. So it's just like little visual cues to kind of like direct attention. And you'll see this stuff all the time. You know, there's 1,000 different systems that work using these kind of techniques. But the use of different panels, progressive release, the use of color is just, it's such an important way in making accessible, usable, easy data environments work for users. So the optimal route is 1B, 2A, 3B, 4B, and 5B. Macarena, what did the crowd do?
Yeah, it was B, A, B, B, B.
Yes, so the wisdom of crowds. So that is the one optimum route through all of the permutations that actually yields the customer service within range and greenhouse gas emissions within range. It's the only scenario. All the other ones blow one of the metrics. So there is wisdom in crowds. So slightly controversial heading. Design is one of the few areas in our world where discrimination can actually be a good thing. You know, starting to think about what does this user need at this point to take the right action, and stripping away everything that they don't need at that point. Accessibility is a big thing. Why we do this is to increase adoption, ease of use, reduce training and documentation burden, and to just widen access for users. And that is us. I think maybe Nick D, what to do is a little. Okay. Paul, are you going to?
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much. Friends from Wyoming, so Rob, Simon, and Macarena, from coming down from Edinburgh and keeping us entertained and informed for this afternoon. I think we've all learned a lot, and I know there's some takeaways that I have, and I'm sure you do as well. Second thing is to thank you for turning up, because this is our first in-person event for two years or so, and we're slightly worried that we might go on our own. So thank you for taking the time out of your busy schedules. As a reward for that, and also as a reward for getting exactly the right answer to the problem, there's actually some drinks outside. So please do stay and have a drink and have a chat to the people from Wyoming and people from the National Innovation Centre for Data on each other over a glass or something. Otherwise, the National Innovation Centre for Data and Wyoming will have to drink it all. We're quite busy people. We've got work to do tomorrow, so we wouldn't want that to happen. So do stay and have a drink. So thank you. Thank you.